So we're just gonna do this first, right? You're okay with this?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Did you just have a big milestone?
Yes.
What was it?
Go for it.
So Judy, I guess we got Danielle first, right? Right. And Judy started coming around, hanging out, getting to know more, paying attention, and decided that you would not take pain medication, right? And so now she's been clean. When did you have your year?
Yesterday.
Yesterday, she had her year.
Basically, I completely surrendered to the fact that I was an addict, and two, that I had to hang out with people in recovery. The longest time I thought that I was better than, didn't want to be a part of, didn't want to let go of old people, places, and things, and that kept me out there for a really long time. And McShin taught me that recovery can be cool, and that other people are like me. And I ran with a good herd, got in with them really quickly, developed relationships, and you know, I still have those relationships, maintain those relationships today. So I think the biggest aspect is the community. Letting go of old people, places, and things. Like, I have old friends that are successful and not addicts, but I can't hang out with them on the weekend. Like, I can keep in contact with them via email, I've got lunch with them occasionally, but when I go hang out with people, it's with people who are in recovery. So that is the main reason that I stayed clean.
Anybody else in here just celebrate any kind of significant milestone? Anybody? Nobody wants to be put on the spot. They're all scared. Who are you whispering to? Who was it?
I said Liz has 4 months and Lisa has 7.
Oh, yeah? Lisa, who has 7?
Lisa D, yeah.
Lisa D has 7 months in recovery. Kristen left us, what, 2 months ago almost? Logan's been in the job for about 2 months, and she's decided that she wants to focus on some other things, and so she did a really good job while she was here, but this is her last week with us as a female director. She will resign on Friday, right?
Yes.
And Aaron, stand up! Program. So any parents of women around here tonight after this meeting, if you want to meet Erin, she'll be right up here. You can meet and talk to her. She's been around for a while. She worked in our jail programs for a long time. She is an alumni. She came through, she's one of the few people I ever see came through, stayed for a month, left, said, I'm gonna keep coming back and continue to come back. And she's continued to work with girls over the past, how long now?
20 months.
20 months, almost 2 years. So she'll be filling that position, and Logan will miss you. Mm-hmm. Aaron, welcome. Thank you. Nitty gritty stuff tonight. What? What?
Anybody new here?
We're gonna get to it. I said we're gonna do the nitty gritty stuff first, and then we're gonna get to the fun stuff. So we're gonna do this thing with Danielle. Stand up. Danielle, she's our official progress letter writer, and Jello, you know, court writer. Like, she writes all the letters that go to court. She writes all the letters that go to the jail. She writes all the letters. They go out just about anywhere. She's the person that writes the letters. There's a form in her door, in her office. You have to fill out that form, and you have to pull it out. Preferably within 48 hours before you go to court. Listen, people. If you come in the day before you have to go to court, and you need a letter, you will not get it from this day forward. So spread the word, because not only does she do letters, she has to get approval before she can write the letter. She has to talk to the female director of programs. She has to talk to the male director of programs. She has to talk to me. So she has to get approval from a lot of places before she can write the letter. She has to get the letter approved after she writes it. So, you know, do yourself a favor. Know when your court date is. And if you need a letter, you better get it before the day before. Because we're not writing letters the day before or the day of anymore. You know, it'll have to be some very, you know. Yes.
Also, please come ask me for your letter, like, yourself. Don't send somebody else to fill out the form for you, because there's a lot of information that your friends and your girlfriends and boyfriends don't know. You know, I need goals and stuff, and I'm not delivering letters. I'm not a mailman.
So, now listen, if you work every single day, you're at work between the hours of 8:30 and 5, feel free to call up here and ask for Danielle. She'll arrange for a way, like I said, the letters are in her door. So you can walk by, grab your letter out of her door thing, and you make the necessary phone calls to make sure you get approval to have the letter written, and then you get it to her. Otherwise, you're not getting a letter. The letters are very important. They make a difference. If you go to court without a letter, you assume that you're not telling the truth. The only thing that proves that you're doing what you say you're doing is by taking the letter. So just, you know, it's a constant battle for us, and you guys have, I know it looks like Danielle's just sitting around gossiping all the time like she's doing now. But the truth is, she has a big job and a lot of responsibilities. She is, you know, she's monitoring a couple of people doing data entry. She does some data entry on her own. And she does just about everything I need done that has to do with sitting in front of a computer. So keep that in mind and make sure that you prepare. Part of being in recovery is really, you know, taking that time and that opportunity to plan things out, not waiting until the last minute, not procrastinating, you know, dealing with these things, which is why we want your weekend plans on Wednesday. There is no asking Megan, Brian, Matthew, whoever's working on the weekends, Tracy, there is no asking them on the weekends, can you do something that's outside of those weekend plans that are written on those plans? You submit them by Wednesday, and if you don't, and anything you ask to do on the weekend, you're going to be told no. It causes too much confusion for people who come in only on the weekends at work. They're not here during the regular week. We work hard during the week, and we really don't want a lot of texts, emails, and phone calls over the weekend. We take them, but we don't like a lot of them. And that's why we ask you to make your plans ahead of time. So make your plans ahead of time. Stop being so. Well, it is unmanageable. Yeah, unmanageable is a good word. So just take the time to make the plans, communicate who you need to communicate with. And if there's going to be a problem, say you've got potential plans, but you don't know if it's going to work out because your family has something else going on, or somebody else that you're going out with may have something going on. You need to communicate that with, if you're a girl, with Aaron, and if you're a guy, with Francis when he's in town. Tonight, I guess you will, if you think you have plans on this weekend, submit the mark. Him and I will go over tomorrow, and I'll put the yes or no on it. You'll have your answer by tomorrow afternoon. But if he doesn't have plans or something you're asking to do over the weekend, By tomorrow, you'll get to do it.
Change of plans, don't tell me until then.
Okay, good. Just do whatever y'all do, okay? Just make it happen. Make sure everybody has a plan, make sure we're not proving I'm bad. There's a lot of people in McShin right now. We're down a house. Week before last, we had a tree fall in one of our houses. The county has put a condemned sticker on. We're waiting on engineers to tell us if we're even going to be able to get back in our house at all. Everybody that's been involved with this, the girls who thought they were getting ready to move and didn't get to move, I appreciate the good attitude and the understanding and no complaining. I like it. It was impressive. I'm proud of you guys for doing that. The guys who had to shuffle everything out of that house and into the new house that really belongs to the girls that we gave you because your house got crushed. You guys have done good too. The transition was really easy. Everybody was pretty much understanding. Those first couple of days with no power were kind of weird, but other than that, it went well. So you guys did a really good job, handling the situation and letting us do the best we can. We're at the mercy of the claims adjuster and the engineer right now. So let it be known that we are working on it. We do have a contractor who's ready to start work immediately. Today, they give us to go ahead and begin rebuilding our house. The plan is to block off the addition side of the house that's crushed, reopen the side of the house that's not damaged, move you guys back in, and hopefully shuffle you girls around like we plan to originally, get some of you closer to McShin again. Let's see. I really didn't have a topic to talk about today. I do know this. There has been a few, incidents over the last couple of weeks. Some with some guys at McSunny, or formerly at McSunny, dealing with race stuff. And then there was another one last night at the Smith House, and just a confrontation, not anything racial. There was some tension over at Women's House this week. And it's important for us to remember that. This is not about our differences. It's not about cover our skin. It's not about our sex. It's not about any of that. We all have a common goal here. And our common denominator is the pain and suffering that we went through in addiction. The loss of relationships, the unmanageability, the jail trips, the courthouses, the degradation. Those are the things that we have in common. All of us have felt that to some degree. And those things drive us to recovery, and our common goal in recovery is to get better. And we're all in this together. And let me tell you, everybody, the majority of the people outside of these walls, they're still fed on bad information about us. They think that we are horrible people and do horrible things. And let me tell you something, we're on drugs, we do horrible things. But the truth is that we're sick people, we can get better. That the other side of addiction is recovery. The solution to addiction is recovery. And we have to, in every area of our life, reflect that. Otherwise, we're just fueling this fire outside. And we're also damaging our own ability to get recovery. And we will be doing that to each other if we're in fight. So you need to look at the people that you're in these houses with. You're all in the same boat. You're all exactly the same in the fact that you need to recover. And that we have a common goal here. So I don't want to hear any more. I don't want to hear anything about, I'm done with that, with the racial stuff. Like, I'm done with it. And I don't think it's completely in the McSunny. Some of it was outside of McShin, but I am done with it. Like, we're not going to put up with it. You will be asked to leave immediately if it comes back up. So if you were involved in it and you were in McShin, you better let it go now. And just be done with it. If you're going to fight and argue in our houses, move out. Because we don't do physical altercations. I've been here for 4 years, and I've yet to have a fist fight. I've had a few little scuffles, but a real fight we haven't had yet. We're not going to have it. And if you're going to be the first person, we're going to call the police. We're going to try to get whoever the victim was to press charges. We're going to push you as hard as we can push you for your behavior if you act out in our houses. You represent recovery. You represent more than just your little self in this building trying to recover. You represent something greater, and so do we. And we're going to run our houses according to that. We're not going to put up with it, And you know, where we should be trying to help each other and understand. And then look, it gets frustrating in a recovery house. I lived in a recovery house for a year. I lived in a Smith house for 7 months. Mm. I get it. You got to deal with 1,000 personalities. You know, one person can have 1,000 personalities, it seems like. So you have to learn to deal with it. The one thing I learned from living in a recovery house, one of the greatest gifts that was given to me in a recovery house was patience and tolerance and forgiveness. Those are things that I wasn't very good at. But I learned living in a recovery house. And the other thing I also learned is that I took care of David's side of the street. If I did what I was supposed to do, if I did the next right thing for the next right reason, every single day, my life got better. Cream rises to the top. And these other people faded away. You know, and I have relationships today with people that came to the house with me, a few of them, that are still clean and doing well. And I've watched others continue to struggle because they continue to hold on to old ideas and old beliefs, and they continue to hold on to hate and anger and stay in that. They chose not to change. They chose not to do the work, and they get that result. So if you want to change, if you want something different, you got to do something different. Like, you can't stay the same. It can't be the same old, same old. Can't be the same outlook, it can't be the same attitude, it can't be the same perspective on everything. You gotta work on change. And it starts, you know, today. Just today. Just do the next right thing for the next right reason today. Begin there. You start with a possibility to succeed. It's real simple stuff, really. Now, Mr. Nietzsche wants to come up and say, let's do this. Who's new before Judy nooses me? Who's new? Anybody new first Wednesday? Who are you guys back here sitting next to?
I'm Brandon Durantich. I'm a recovering addict and alcoholic.
Where are you live?
Right now, McSunny
House. McSunny House. Welcome.
Thank you.
Who's next to you?
My name is Sean. I'm an addict. Down at McSunny House.
Right on. How long have you been
there? Been there since Thursday last week.
All right. It's always a different beast, man. Quickly, if I didn't go out of recovery house, I really think I'd go to McSunny.
It's all right, I'd like to remember.
Good. Back there, what's up, Jimmy?
My name is Caitlin. I'm actually Rita's cousin. I'm not an addict, but I just got out of a relationship with one, and I'm coming to support her and, you know, just learn more about it.
So you just got out of a relationship with her? How did you do that with take hostages?
Oh.
We got a family meeting upstairs right after this meeting. It's going to be perfect for you.
Don't worry.
All right. Where is it? There she is. Come on. I don't even know what she wants to talk about. I don't know what she wants to talk. She wants to talk about her recovery experience at McShin, her son's recovery, and, you know, how it's affected her and her family's life. I'm pretty sure that's what it is.
Yes, it is.
Welcome.
Yes,
thank you.
Well, first of all, I wanted to share that our entire family owes a huge debt of gratitude to McShin, to John Shinholzer, David Rook, and also Francis, who spent many long hours in recovery coaching with our son. And I want to start off by saying that my son, Joseph Panici, who's not here right now, he's working, has been at McShin for 13 months. And last summer, John came to Campbell County Court with our attorney, and we petitioned the judge to let our son come here for recovery. And at that time, my son, of course, was in jail. He'd spent 14 months in the Lynchburg Adult Detention Center. And he came out in shackles and chains, and next Wednesday he will go back for the end of his furlough and for his sentencing. And this time when he goes back, he will go in a suit and tie with his head held up, having worked very hard in recovery. And I want to also mention what David was saying, that this is bigger than just each of ourselves. Because our attorney told our son last summer, he said, Joe, he said, this is bigger than you. He says, if you fail in your recovery and while you're out on furlough, the next time that someone comes before Judge Cook in Campbell County requests requesting a furlough, he's going to remember this, and he's going to say, no, I let that other guy go, and it didn't work out. So I want to say that we are enormously grateful that my son was not easy to work with. He's very stubborn, but fortunately, David Brooks' patience and long-suffering that he learned in the Smith House came into play, and it was not smooth sailing. And I really want to say that for new people and new parents, it was not smooth sailing. When he got out, he wasn't sure about this recovery stuff. He wanted to do it the other way around. He wanted, first of all, to get his life back together, and then maybe add in a little bit of recovery. But all in all, and then on top of that, he had an injury to his shoulder where his tendon came clean off of the shoulder bone because he works out, and he had to have orthopedic surgery. So the big issue then was, well, is he going to, how are we going to do this without opening meds? Well, he was able to get through the entire surgery with just what they call a catheter. And no opiate meds for the 6 months that he had to go through physical therapy. During that time, he was in a lot of pain, working on his recovery. He also passed his personal trainer's exam, got a job as a trainer down at the Crunch Gym, and now he's been promoted to the assistant fitness manager at the Crunch Gym over in Short Pump. And in addition to that, he mentors young boys from the Richmond Boys Club every week at the gym where he gives them free personal training. And many of these boys have fathers that are incarcerated on drug charges. And my son loves doing this. So I want to say this to encourage all parents that recovery does happen. And especially for people who are new here, or if you're not new, please honor and respect your leaders here. They really look out for you. The stakes are so high. The stakes are so high. And I just wanted to just let McShin and everyone here know how much we appreciate everything they do here. It's really phenomenal. It's really great.
Stand up. Did you raise your hand when I asked if you were new?
Yes,
you did?
I missed you. I did.
I apologize. Here's two other new guys, man. They're the, we call it the new Dunbar.
No.
Smith House 2.0.
So, well, they got you guys on the yesterday, right?
Yes, sir.
Good.
There's another.
Who is it? Where is it? What are you doing, man? Who are you?
A DJ.
Damn it, DJ, man. I've been waiting to meet you for weeks now.
Yeah, I'm just
work for Jeff Tuck, right?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yeah, I'm just coming in trying to get my life straight. Trying to surrender myself to the program because I can't do it on my own. I feel like an infant in this whole ordeal, so I could use all the help I can get.
Alright, well, glad you're here. You got pretty. Who are we talking
about? Oh, yeah. Introduce yourself. I'm Cammie. Well, the other Cammie.
The other Cammie?
You showed up yesterday. I did. I showed up with
the book bag, and that was it. And man, Micah came out of my office. He said, man, we got a girl down there. She has no resources, we've got a bed, I want to give her a bed. I said, no, we got too many people right now that haven't paid us. We're not getting the intake from enough people to do it. He went back to his office, and him and Logan and Aaron, I think, were down there talking. I was sitting in my office, and I was like, damn. She showed up, she's got a backpack with her, she's going to, whatever. So I went down to the office and took her, and I really hope that, I hope you do well. So just, pay attention, talk to Aaron, take some suggestions, and you'll do just fine.
Another one.
Oh, Lord, where'd you come from? you power can. Oh, yeah, I talked to that guy on the phone about you yesterday. So what's your name?
My name's Morgan.
Morgan? All right. From Powhatan. Good. Welcome. Some of you are aware that we have a Carolina County Recovery Community Program, right? Court referral program. And we've had a director out there since we started. His name is Frank Brewer. Frank's in the hospital with his cancer. I got a text message just before this meeting started that he may or may not have about 6 months to live. So, if you know Frank, if you don't know Frank, if you'd like to send a card, if you are praying, folk, pray. If you just want to send, you know, condolences to his wife or his, you know, his family, just honestly would be your point of contact for that. And just let her know she'll get everything to her. If you're friends with him and you want to know where he's at so you can visit him, again, honestly, it's a point of contact. She'll get you there to do that. Frank's a different kind of guy, but he's sure he's a trooper. And most likely, if and when Frank dies, that program in Carolina County may go with him. It's kind of sad. So just keep him in your thoughts if you can. Keep his wife Cindy in your thoughts as well. Debbie, Heidi, anybody got anything?
Well, first off, I'm glad that Suzanne had the courage to get up and talk, and Dave, I need to thank you too. I didn't plan on saying this, so. 4 years ago, Monday, Boy came, and you lived with him for a long time. You helped my family more than you'll ever know. So on the July 4th, that's like his 4-year anniversary, his clean date. He came in clean. He had been in a rehab for 6 weeks prior, but thank you so much for what you did. I want to report that a few of us, Tay, went to the Chesterfield County. We went to a church and met with the HARP parents, the Heroin Addiction Recovery Program parents, and had a Families Anonymous meeting kind of with them. Hope to do it maybe once a month. It was, I think, a great success. Not that many people showed up, but that's the way these meetings go. I think that we were able to help the parents who did show up. And secondly, for those who are new, I want to let you know that there's a meeting in this room at 7, Families Anonymous. Moses has a meeting upstairs on the third floor for new families to McShin, and downstairs in the boardroom there's a meeting for siblings. So thanks again.
Perfect. Speaking of the HARP program, I met with Captain Pritchett and another guy. What's that officer's name?
W. Nokunis.
Nokunis?
Nokunis.
Yeah, Nokunis. Anyways, I met with two deputies today, two officers from over at Chesterfield County Jail, and we're going to do something we've never done, and the sheriff's going to allow something that's never been allowed here at McShin before. They're going to take people with an active sentence, non-violent, drug-offended people with an active sentence. They're going to put an ankle monitor on them. They're going to let them out to do house arrest and, you know, work release, and they're going to live in McShin, be monitored by McShin, and they're going to be able to serve, you know, an active sentence outside of the walls of jail here at McShin, you know, getting recovery support services. So that is, you know, so we met today, we talked about them. Brian gave a green light on the guy to go. I'm guessing Tay feels the same way about Hunter. So we'll be looking forward to in the next week to start that program. It's just unreal. And if we could get that going in more and more places around this country, we'd have a lot less problems, man. I mean, it's awesome.
That's still such a leader.
There you go. Good day, that's fair. There are no women in the Chesterfield County jails.
Yeah, what about the women who are sentenced?
There are no women in the Chesterfield County jail, which means the sheriff has no jurisdiction over those women. They belong to
Riverside.
Now, if you want to get a for-profit jail and start letting inmates out, you try. Look, I'm going to let Harlan get around to it for a minute, but I keep seeing something. Max, will you please stand up so I can get it on camera? Please. It is the most awesome shirt I think I've ever seen. His shirt says, what does it say? Exercising my right to bear arms. It's the greatest shirt ever. Come on. Thank you. That's awesome. Okay. We got the whole fabric thing going tonight. Good. Mateo, you got anything?
Good.
Nothing? Nope. You always got something to say. You got nothing to say to me. Mateo?
All of them got
something. Yeah, Darius, you got anything to say? I'm sure.
He's skipping me, but
Love? Daniel? Mikey's always telling you, so what you got, Brian?
No, I'm going to say something. This don't have nothing to do with the jail, but, you know, as I was outside, man, sitting there, looking around, right, with all the blue shirts on and shit, right? Stand up, John. Right? John, how many of y'all work for John, or have worked for John? It's more than that. It just ain't in here. All right? Man, look, man, that's a big deal, man. That's a big deal. Like, I didn't want to, like, give him some recognition, man, but to come up here and put all these guys to work, man, some of these guys can't find a job nowhere. You know what I mean? Not only does John put them to work, but John pays them decently, you know, so, you know, very well. And it gives a lot of these guys something to do, man, because it's real easy to get hopeless, man, when we're sitting here, you know, we're trying to get our lives together and we can't find a job. You know, a lot of people come to McShin and get their stuff together, and then they haul. They haul tail up the road and say, you know, whatever, McShin, right? But John is still here and is not only being productive, but is giving back to help the recovery community. So I just want to give John a shout out, man.
There's the food truck court that we've been doing. Judy organizes the first and third Tuesday all summer, so that'll be on the 5th. On the 9th, there's a Flying Squirrels fundraiser game that a portion of the proceeds go to McShin. I have the tickets up here. I can sell some after, and then we'll also, anytime up until the 9th, but I'll have them at the 4th of July picnic also. On the 21st, there's a book signing with Mark Melanter. He's coming down from New York to talk about his book, What is Alcoholics Anonymous? It's about the scientific effectiveness of 12-step programs. And that's free and open to everyone, but there's also a VIP signing that John has organized beforehand that'll have food and include your book purchase and a photo with Mark. And then Recovery Fest is September 10th. And then every Sunday in here, we have the Recovery Spiritual Awakening Service, where families and people in recovery speak and share their stories. So, and my new intern, Mike, will come pass out these stuff. Yes. Come on, Mike.
Michael.
I told you.
Fine. Anybody have anything that they would like to say tonight? And yes.
Her dad died of cancer, and she didn't really have a lot of time with him. And then a little over the anniversary date of her dad's death, her mom had a brain aneurysm and died. And she was 1 month and 13 days clean, and it's like the best I have seen her. So I just want to like say I'm really proud of her for that.
Some voice to and how you can get there. One of the things that happens in the group is that love is paramount. Love is first. And all of the things that are required of parents, it just doesn't happen overnight or the first time. So to give yourself a break, as we say in recovery, is really important. But we certainly hope that you will come upstairs and let's see if we can't come together. Okay?
Thanks, man. Thank you, man.